Welcome back to another episode of The Personal Collection. This is episode number 6, and I'm here with Jeff. On Twitter, you can find him at DTD, and he has one of the best Lefty O'Doul collections. How are you doing today, Jeff?
Good. How are you?
Doing pretty well. I got to ask, why Lefty O'Doul? There's a ton of different players, a pre-war that people collect. You're the biggest collector for O'Doul. Why him?
I got asked that. I've been asked that a lot. I think that the biggest reason, mostly the Japan stuff, mostly the ambassador, the fact that he went to Japan. When I was growing up, batting average was a little bit bigger deal, and he has a very high lifetime batting average, and I just never really understood why he wasn't in the Hall. But now I kind of understand that they can't combine the ambassador part of it along with the short playing career and the high batting average.
Okay. Now, tell me a little bit about his career. You mentioned that he was an ambassador to Japan and also that they couldn't combine stats. I know we talked a little bit before the show how he also played in the California Pacific Coast League. Talk about how he transitioned from over there to the MLB and like kind of what he did.
He actually started off the early 20s and he was a pitcher for the New York Yankees. He didn't really make it as a pitcher, but he could all, back then, of course, the pitchers hit, but he could always hit. And so he had people in his ear saying, you know, you should make the transition to hitter. And he really rejected it for a long, long, long period of time. So from about the period of 1919 to about 1927, 28, he was not really a major league player. He played in the PCL, I think he transitioned to the outfield in about 1925-ish. I could be wrong, but right somewhere around in there. Played in the Pacific Coast League for a few years and then ended up making it back to the majors as an outfielder.
Now, one of the cool things about the Pacific Coast League is the cards they made for him, the Z-Nut cards. Was that his first card or did he have something while he played with the Yankees?
The very first card that I am aware of or that I own is a Z-Nut.
Okay.
There possibly could be something before that's out of my price range or just that I haven't even seen yet.
Yeah, sometimes those strip cards that are out there that are not documented fully, or those occasional sets can get you sometimes. So why don't you show off a few of your Lefty O'Doul cards that you have and kind of tell the story of the card or how you ended up acquiring them.
Okay, this is the Z-Nut. This is the very first card I have. Obviously not in great shape, but these are not very easy to find. This is from 1927 when he played for the San Francisco Seals. And then the back is blank. So they are fairly boring cards. It's not supposed to be round, but it's a Z-Nut, so it's round. They're, like I said, they're just very hard. They're very thin and they're hard to find in good condition. That would be the first card that he has. This probably would be the first major league issue. This is a exhibit with a postcard back.
There we go. Just saw it now.
Okay.
So were all the exhibits postcards then, or was it just for that early release? I know they had two different runs? They had one earlier pre-war, and then I know they had a later one during like the 40s and 50s.
Yeah, exhibits, I think, started in 1921 or 22, and they went all the way through. They actually did two different postcard backs, I believe, one in the 20s and then another one in the 60s, where I believe a one-year issue thing. The rest of them are pretty much blank backed.
And those were what, from like vending machines, or how do you end up getting those cards back then?
Actually from vending machines. You're not exactly sure how much money that you put in the machine, but you put your money in the machine, you pulled the, like back in the day where I used to get little plastic football helmets or something like that when we would go out to eat. But it was the same type of thing. They were actually in the vending machines, correct?
Yeah, that's the craziest thing about collecting. Everyone always assumes it's with tobacco or it's with gum or taffy or anything else like that, you know, food and beverage, but there's so many different vending machine cards.
And the exhibits are actually still a good way to grab star cards of players that, like a Joe DiMaggio type thing. You can actually grab an exhibit for 100 and 120 bucks or something like that, where you're not sniffing a Joe DiMaggio.
Oh, definitely not. His Gaudi stuff is so expensive. It's 38. And then on top of it, some of his play balls. Ouch.
Yes. I got something else I was going to show you that isn't exactly a card.
Go ahead.
I don't know if you can see it. This is a information card of his from the Baseball Bureau of Hellman-Bronner. And so this is like what they had in card catalogs, not the matchbook. The matchbook is just in here, but it's got his whole full address, year of birth. And then this is the teams that he played on. So you can see that he started in 1916 for San Francisco. And by 1927, he was still in San Francisco. But in the meantime, he had played for the Yankees in 1922. So this has the years on it.
Now, what does that bureau do specifically? Why they have all that information?
I don't know the complete story, but I know that they were just one of the bureaus that like kept information on the players and things like that for publications. And, you know, they're obviously pre-internet. If you wanted to write a story or something.
And get all the information.
Correct.
I didn't know they had those type of different agencies out there that kept all the records. I mean, it makes sense.
But that's kind of one of my favorite pieces. I don't think that there's too much value attached to it, but I enjoy it because for one thing, I probably should have pulled that out first thing. I could have went over the years. I could have told you every year he played for every team, but
hey, that's all right.
Didn't even think about it.
Now, how did you acquire that piece? That's not something you can just go to a card show and see every day.
That was actually acquired from a private auction. Probably this was the hardest piece that I found. I was looking for this next card for a couple of different years. I was finally able to acquire it within the last 6 months. And then, ironically enough, I found it again. After not finding it for 6 months, I was able to find one not graded, which, of course, is the way things work. But yep. This is a George Miller card.
George Miller. Let's see what it looks like. Oh, I've seen those before. Was that a 33, I think? Or what was it?
Yes, it's a 33.
That's what I thought. I was like, I know there's a few different releases in 33. I couldn't remember if the Miller was or not.
Yeah, the 33 was a great collecting year. Between that, there's also the DeLong.
Yep.
That's from 33. You know, of course, the Gaudis. Everybody knows the Gaudis. So there, yeah, 33 was probably.
And you have the Orbits as well.
Exactly. Yep.
And I'm guessing Xena also produced in 33.
They would have had to, correct.
You told me it was like a 20-year run. So I didn't know about Xena's producing in 33. I know they had the DiMaggio rookie card, technically, or pre-rookie card, because it wasn't major league level. Like 4 or 5 different releases there alone, plus whatever other strip cards are out there that were released that year.
There's the Worst Cigar was also from 33.
Okay, I haven't seen those before.
Yeah, that wasn't very easy either. That's what I actually did. I pulled out a bunch of 33s. It's a very attractive year for cards.
It is. It's honestly probably the best year for cards if you think about it, between all the different brands. I know today there's like 30, 40 different types of cards out there, but for 33, it's so much.
So many different cool sets.
Yeah, we have the whole Topps monopoly since the 50s all the way pretty much through the 70s. Singular brand, but back in pre-war, you could find everything, kind of like today.
Yeah, that's kind of one of those years that it's like, oh my gosh, that came out that year, that came out that year, as I started getting into the older cards.
And the crazy thing is a lot of these companies only produced 1 year. They're one-hit wonders. It's a shame because, I mean, imagine how much the lungs would go design-wise if they continue to produce or tattoo Orbits.
Well, they had that pesky World War II.
I know.
It got in the way of everything.
That ruined the Gaudi company because they didn't produce after then. And then Playball changed their name to Bowman.
Yeah, that definitely changed everything. This is a postcard from Japan, from when Lefty toured Japan. And I'm not sure how any of this is coming out. I'm trying my best.
No, it's fine. I can see it well.
And then again, that's got a postcard back.
So did he tour Japan at the same time as like the Catcher with the Spy, Ruth and Gehrig and all the other players? Or did he do a separate tour?
No, he was the one who actually brought Mo Berg to Japan.
He brought them over. Okay.
Yes, it was his tour.
So what's the story on how he ended up bringing them over?
Oh, boy. I mean, I know he was fascinated with the Japanese culture. He went over on a tour and then he kept in touch with people and wanted to go back. I mean, to just make it a very quick story here. But I mean, he kept in touch. He was fascinated with the culture and he stayed friends with some people over there and was able to, you know, they asked him to bring back other groups. When he toured Japan, his last trip, that was the one that was after World War II. And that was kind of a big deal, political negotiations between the countries, because we had obviously just dropped two nuclear
bombs. Yeah.
Yes. And that was sort of the first diplomatic thing. I mean, General MacArthur actually asked for, he didn't bring a tour of a team of major leagues, but he brought the San Francisco Seals at that point, which he was the manager. He was actually an American they liked.
They let him over.
It had a little bit of significance.
I had no idea. That's a good trivia question right there.
The postcard I just showed you was from the Babe Ruth Lou Gehrig tour pre-World War II.
I was going to say at the National, they had a full uniform. I think it was Gehrig there, and it was so cool to see it in person.
Oh, I can only imagine. I would have loved that. See, these are some supplements from his Japanese newspapers and things from when the SEALs.
I'm guessing they made some special cards of that as well.
They do.
That's so cool.
These are the, is it one side's English and the other side's
Japanese. Now, did the SEALs end up turning into be like a minor league team? Or are they independent league now? Or did they just disperse, no longer around?
They're no longer around. They, once the Giants moved from New York, there was really no need for the SEALs at that point.
Yeah.
Here's a couple of what are called Menkos. I'm sure you know this, but somebody might not. I only have three, but these are all from when Lefty toured.
Really don't see Japanese cards that often.
And that's been kind of a really fun aspect of collecting Lefty Odul, is I've been able to kind of dive into that. And I've been able to, you know, I realize I'm not going to grab every Menko that was made of Lefty Odul tomorrow on eBay, because they're just not there. Some of it requires patience and waiting, and sometimes that's good for the budget anyway.
I know how that goes, man. There's so many cards you want to buy, and it's like budget versus finding that card again. Sometimes it's the sacrifice of everything. It's tough.
Exactly. But yeah, that was pretty much all I pulled out.
No, that was really cool. So any final thoughts you want to talk about, like between either Japanese cards or Lefty Odul cards, if anyone wants to learn a little bit more?
Sometimes I don't even think I'm an expert. I just think I'm a collector. And so, I mean, anyone can send me a message or anything if they have questions. The greatest thing about Twitter is I've met some really great friends. So if I don't know, and a lot of times I don't know, I kind of know who to ask now. So I have some really good resources that can help me out with the Menko cards. Just looking at them, I don't know if they're Lefty Odul. I mean, I don't, and I can't read the Japanese on the back. And a lot of times it's just ads anyway. So, I mean, I think that anyone has any questions, definitely shoot them to me. I may not know the answer, but I can definitely help them get that. That's all. Oh, I was just going to say a lot of people have helped me.
No, I can agree with that on Twitter. It's an awesome community. And if you guys are watching this right now, you don't have a Twitter account, make sure to make one right now and follow Jeff on there. Hey, I really appreciate you being on the show. I learned a lot today. And guys, make sure to check his Twitter out. It is Odeet Didi. And that was it for episode 6. Thanks again, Jeff.
All right. Thank you.